Hello, my name is Roman Zwicky. I'm from the University of Edinburgh and I work in particle physics. And in this MOOC, I'll be presenting to you the theory of strong interactions, also known as quantum chromodynamics. I hope you'll enjoy. Strong and weak force, the two missing microscopic forces. As a matter of fact, there are four fundamental forces in nature, out of which we have seen two so far. Gravitation, corresponding to attraction of masses, as seen in part two, and electromagnetism, corresponding to attraction of charges, as seen in part three. They are well known in our macroscopic world, for example, through the orbiting of planets and the propagation of light, respectively. In the advent of the age of particle physics, it became clear that there ought to be more forces. First, the nucleus, made out of protons and neutrons, is held together very strongly. Gravitation is too weak, and electromagnetism is repelling, as protons carry positive charge. Hence, there has to be a strong force binding the nucleus together, which operates on the microscopic or nuclear scale. Second, beta decay. The neutron decays into a proton plus other particles with very small probability. It therefore seems reasonable to assume that this decay is governed by a weak force. In the following lectures, we're going to discuss the nature of the strong and the weak force, what the force carriers are, analogous to the photon in electromagnetism, and why they're not experienced in the macroscopic world. Concerning the latter, I shall remind you that the potential in electromagnetism and gravitation is proportional to 1 over the distance. This is due to the force carriers, the photon and the graviton, having no rest mass. By virtue of E equals mc squared equals zero, no virtual energy needs to be created, and the force carriers can propagate freely. We will see that the potential of the strong force is proportional to the distance, and therefore radically different. The potential of the weak force is exponentially suppressed by a mass associated with the weak force carriers. The Higgs mechanism has got everything to do with this mass. Strong interactions. The way the theory of strong interactions were uncovered is rather subtle. Information came from a never-ending series of discoveries of new particles. It eventually led to the idea that the discovered particles are bound states made of more elementary constituents called quarks. We will see that their proliferation can be understood as coming from different arrangements of these quarks. For the sake of clarity, we shall from now on mostly explain the facts, since the full story of the discovery of the strong interactions is rather intricate. Quantum chromodynamics. Quantum electrodynamics, or QED for short, can be understood as the theory of interactions between electrically charged objects, such as the electron, and the electromagnetic force carrier, the photon. In analogy, the strong force can be understood as the interaction of particles called quarks, carrying color charge, and the strong force carrier, the gluon. The quarks are matter particles of spin 1/2, and the gluons are force carriers of spin 1. The most important difference to QED is that the gluons also carry color charge, and therefore can interact with itself, which I have drawn in a set of so-called Feynman graphs. This is due to the color charge being more elaborate. More precisely, the color charge can have three different qualities, which are called red, green, and blue. The analog of plus and minus for the electric charge may be thought of as red and anti-red. All these colorful words led particle physicists to name the theory of strong interactions quantum chromodynamics, or QCD for short. The term strong interaction and QCD shall be used interchangeably from now on. This is the QCD kinetic minus potential term in so-called Lagrangian form, which I merely write down because it fits on one line. The first term corresponds to the analog of the Dirac equation for QED, as seen in part three. The second term gives rise to the generalization of Maxwell's equation in vacuum, as seen in part two. You're not supposed to be familiar with this equation for the remainder of this course. It is remarkable, though, that one, if not the most complicated theory in nature can be written on one line and yet is so hard to solve as such. For completeness, we mention that the quarks also carry electric charges. In QED, we have seen that there are electrons, muons and taus, where the muons and taus can be thought of as heavy electrons. Similarly, the quarks come in different types, called flavors. Actually, there are six flavors: up, down, strange, charm, beauty and top, in increasing weight. The last quark, the top, was only directly confirmed in 1995 at Fermilab near Chicago. It is time to return to the beginning of this lecture and fit the protons and the neutrons back into the new picture. They correspond to up, up, down and up, down, down bound states. The up quark and down quark carry 2/3 and minus 1/3 electric charge, respectively. Therefore, the proton made out of up, up, down carries 2/3 plus 2/3 minus 1/3 equals 1 unit of electric charge. And the neutron made out of up, down, down carries 2/3 minus 1/3 minus 1/3 equals 0 units of electric charge. The quarks are bound together into the proton by continuously exchanging gluons. Let us add some terminology. Bound states of so-called quarks are called hadrons. This explains why the CERN experiment is called Large Hadron Collider, as two hadrons, namely protons, are collided at high energy. The large range of particles discovered by the physicists in the 1950s can therefore be understood as variations thereof, interchanging the light flavors of up, down and strange quarks. For example, the bound state made out of up, down and strange is known as the lambda and weighs approximately 1.2 times the proton mass. This scheme can be thought of as the analog of the periodic table of particle physics. This is a nice picture, but there are still paradoxical aspects. QED as well as QCD are gauge theories, and with the caveats of the yet-to-be-discussed Higgs mechanism, imply that the force carriers have no mass, and therefore should act at the macroscopic scale. Here is the paradox. How come the strong force only operates on the microscopic scale? This is related to our next topic of confinement and asymptotic freedom. Confinement and asymptotic freedom. Possibly the most puzzling aspect of QCD is that mathematically it is defined in terms of quarks and gluons, but neither have ever appeared in a particle detector in isolated form. That this can never happen is known as the confinement hypothesis. Whereas the hydrogen atom can be split into its two constituents, the electron and the proton, the same is not possible for the hadrons. This was the real puzzle. It is therefore not surprising that it was largely thought that quarks had no reality, but were merely convenient mathematical objects, bringing some order into the world of hadrons. In 1969, experiments in deep inelastic scattering gave the community new results. In those experiments, energetic photons probed the proton. The best interpretation was that the quarks could be thought of as free particles within the proton. By free, we mean that no force acts on them. Let us summarize the situation. Experiments suggest that the quarks interact weakly at short distances, known as asymptotic freedom, and very strong at large distances, confinement, binding colored objects such as quarks and gluons into bound states. The challenge for particle physicists was to show that these two properties are contained within the QCD equations. This is easily said, but totally counterintuitive, as in QED, it works just the other way around. More precisely, charges are known to be screened in QED. Imagine a charge placed into the vacuum. If a virtual pair of opposite charges is created from the vacuum, then the initial charge will attract the one of opposite charge. This is analogous to a polarized medium. The net effect is that from a distance, it will look like there is less charge. To see this, we place a charge into such a configuration, and we see that the virtual charges counteract the effect of the initial charge. Therefore, the electromagnetic force get stronger at short distances due to quantum effects. The idea of asymptotic freedom in QCD is to turn this picture upside down. In 1973, it was indeed shown mathematically using the QCD equations that the force does become smaller at short distances. The discovery of asymptotic freedom in QCD led to the Nobel Prize for Politzer, Gross and Wilczek in 2004. Possibly we should add that the word asymptotic refers to small distances. The new key feature, as with respect to QED, is the self-interacting nature of the gluons, which turns the screening picture, described for QED, upside down. The fact that the force is small at short distances complies with the force being strong at large distances. Using the QCD equations, it has been shown through elaborate computer simulations, as performed at Edinburgh University, that the force is indeed strong at large distances and leads to the confinement of quarks inside the hadrons. An ab initio analytical approach to confinement is one of the great outstanding problems of particle physics. At the qualitative level, the lines of forces for two QED and QCD charges look as follows. The photon flux lines spread out into the entire space and therefore weaken with distance. The gluon flux lines are squeezed into one dimension and do not weaken. The force is therefore independent of the distance. This implies that the potential scales linearly with the distance, as announced at the beginning of the lecture. Let us summarize the picture of confinement. One cannot isolate colored particles. Only color-neutral particles can propagate over long distances. This is the explanation of why the strong interactions are of short range. The force carrier of the strong interactions, the gluon, has color charge and can therefore not act at a long range, despite having no rest mass. Let us mention, as it is of importance for the Higgs discovery plots, that when a quark pair is pulled apart to a certain distance, then it is energetically favorable to break up into two color-neutral quark pairs. This leads to the formation of so-called jets of color-neutral particles in high-energy experiments. The puzzle of why the weak force is not of long-range nature has a very different solution and has got everything to do with the Higgs mechanism, to be discussed in forthcoming lectures. That's it from me. I hope you have enjoyed.